Why the Geshelli Labs Archel 3 Pro headphone amplifiers considered one of today's best amplifiers? Eh? What are all these buttons for here? How do the Sparkos Labs SS2590 Pro operation amplifier used in influence the sound? What about the preamp output for? How does it compare to the Erish 3 Pro from the same company, and why I did a choose for the Archel 3? How about the chassis? Wood or aluminium? Hi, I am Neri, your preferred electronic engineer who talks about audio, I believe so. Let's talk about this gear. This gear is 99% analog. I will talk about more later in this video. But that acquisition made a vast difference in my setup, and I will explain the why in this video. Before, about the Geshelli Labs and the Sparkos Labs, both are small North American companies that develop and produce hi-fi audio electronics in small quantities. In this case, Sparkos Labs develops only the operational amplifier, which makes all the difference in the electronics. Since Geshelli is a small company, please understand that you will order, pay in advance, and wait for the item for a few weeks. Remember, you must still pay import taxes according to your country's legislation, because they do not collect taxes before sending you the device. This one in aluminum arrived here in Portugal in 2 weeks. It has an aluminum chassis in charcoal color and smoke-colored acrylics. In the order, you can configure the basic appearance of your equipment. Why did I choose aluminum instead of wood? Well, the wooden chassis seems more beautiful to me, okay. They also have a wide choice of wood types. But aluminum wins over wood when it comes to longevity, thermal dissipation, and some electromagnetic protection. I will do a simple unboxing because the company has no investment in backend here. I think it's good. I wonder if it should, because using impactful packing would make the sale price even more expensive. I will discuss the price at the end of the video. So turn to the specs. The amplifier came with a small power supply with 12 volts and 1 ampere capacity, which is enough but could be better. My suggestion is to add a power buffer with supercapacitors after that power supply, or a complete new power supply with significant capacitance as a large output buffer. Link to these items in the description. And now let's look inside the equipment. But wait, do the other channels about audio that you already follow, they do that too? So why have you yet to sign up for those channels and haven't subscribed here? That's weird. Think about it. Now that you have subscribed here, thank you, I can continue. When you open this amplifier, you need to be careful not to break the acrylic and not to damage this thin wire that is attached to a screw underneath, at least in the aluminum version. The wooden chassis will not have that, I believe. Here, the question is avoiding electrical discharges through the potentiometers, because the chassis also conducts loads. Look at PCB. Let's start with the power supply circuit. We have a typical source input capacitance. A voltage of minus 12 volts is generated from the positive voltage of 12 volts input. Then both are stabilized to a lower voltage with the traditional linear voltage regulators LM317 and LM337. The voltage is set to power the entire circuit and probably plus and minus 9 volts or a little more than that to ensure the smooth operation of the Sparkos Labs SS2590, which works at least with plus and minus 9 volts. It's the minimum voltage. Another voltage regulator is in parallel to this and generates a lower voltage to power the digital circuit. How does a digital circuit exist inside a piece of equipment that is supposed to be all analog? This amplifier can be viewed as a smart amplifier because these buttons do not act directly on the analog circuit. That's good. These buttons are all connected to an Atmel microcontroller, microchip, in fact, similar to Arduino microcontrollers. And when detecting a change in the button states, the microcontroller acts on these special relays for analog signals. This approach of relays rather than switches directly connected to the analog circuit ensures more longevity and avoids constant maintenance, as a mechanical switch directly connected to the circuit can cause many problems over time. Here, even the power button will trigger a relay, so there is always a delay between clicking the button and making the change. So be patient. The digital circuit always consumes energy if the external source is connected to the headphone amplifier. The power button has two functions, turns on and off, of course, and when turned on by clicking again, the RGB LED inside changes the color or turns the LED off. The second button triggers the tone control, a simplified equalizer that only changes lower and higher frequencies. If you don't press this button, this tone control will be removed from the circuit and the amplifier will operate without changes on this equalization. Be careful not to get confused. The leftmost potentiometer controls the high frequencies and the rightmost potentiometer controls the low frequencies. I believe this positioning was used to facilitate and improve the layout of the tracks on the PCB. This tone control helps me overcome the low and sub-low frequencies issues of my headphones and the high frequency deficiencies of my R2R DAC type, which I commented on this video linked here. That adjustment makes a lot of difference. In this case, I use a maximum of 20% of the potentiometer's cushion. I would even like a finer adjustment to be possible, at least in my setup, more than 20% already sounds completely wrong. But if your setup does not need an adjustment, does it really? And if you want more gain, more dynamic range, and a balanced headphone output, your choice is the Erish 3 Pro, okay? The third button selects the audio input, whether by the unbalanced RCA connection, the default option, or through the balanced XLR connection, which needs to be, of course, switched on by this button. Just clarify, using good quality RCA cables that are less than 2 meters in length and shielded cables, you do not have to worry about having a balanced sound system. Do not freak about it, okay? Do not freak about it, because I will leave links to good RCA cables in the description as well. Now, the last and most important button is the gain button. I advise you not to test the volume for the first time with headphones on your ears, okay? Leave them on your neck, depending on your headphones and the music you choose. This can even damage your eardrums, yeah? It is powerful at this level, even though it only has an unbalanced output for the headphones. If your headphones and ears allow it, I suggest you leave on the high gain. My headphones, the SHP9500 by Philips and the Focal Clear MG Pro, both have 32 ohms of impedance. It's the most common impedance as a standard for headphones. Both have equivalent volumes levels, and this setup works perfect for both. Both have deficiencies in the low and sub-low frequencies. I only increased the tone of the high because, as I said, my DAC F5 KLF R2R has a bizarre deficiency in the high. I already commented in the link. This amplifier can supply you up to 2 watts of total sound power for 32 ohms of impedance. That's a lot, and your ears wouldn't take the air pressure provided by all that power. If your headphones have 250 ohms of impedance, this maximum power will be almost 130 milliwatts per channel. It seems minor, but it's not. I suggest you to set the gain, the volume adjustment, high enough that you can hear even the lowest volume sounds in your music or content, and set the amplifier's gain far from the maximum. If that setting is more than 50%, it's already possible that the amplification circuit is causing some distortion. And before discussing the SS2590 from Sparkos Labs, the operation amplifier circuit responsible for giving all this power to the headphones output, I need to comment about the other operation amplifier that appears in the other three parts of the circuit. One, it appears at the circuit that transforms the balanced XLR input signal into unbalanced. Two, in the tone control circuit. And three, in the volume control circuit before gaining power. In all of them, we have the integrated circuit OP1656 from Texas Instruments. This IC has been widely used in the latest audio equipment releases because it is the evolution of the IC OP1642, also from Texas Instruments, which was the most used in the high-performance audio equipment until then. This new operation amplifier improved the slew rate, the parameter equivalent to improving audio equipment's attack and release time. It is an integrated and small component. It does not provide power, so understand that its application is more convenient when we want to transform audio into a voltage level. Suppose we want audio in form of power or electric current to move the coils in your headphones, for example. The best option is the SS2590 from Sparkos Labs. It is a discrete operation amplifier, since you notice every discretized element in your circuit. Unlike an integrated operation amplifier, you don't know exactly what is inside. Sparkos Labs has been able to improve the parts independently and made it operate as a Class A amplifier, up to 13% limit of its total power capacity, more or less. Above 13%, it becomes a Class AB amplifier. Class AB and Class D amps always add some distortion, which may or may not be noticeable to your ears. The problem with Class A amplifiers is the efficiency. Imagine that the system consuming almost 10 watts to deliver less than 1 watt of sound. So we have 90 watts that will be transformed into heat dissipation. That is why you will hardly hear about Class A power amplifiers for speakers. Class A amplifiers are commonly used in professional studio gear, such as mixing consoles, which consume a lot of energy because that. Although its energy performance isn't perfect, the sound is perfect, or very close to it. In What about the preamp output? Imagine that you have another analog piece of equipment, such as a cassette deck, and you want the audio to enter this equipment with the best possible definition and volume. Thus, you would add less gain and consequently less noise with the internal gain of the cassette deck, which you know is not so good. Another use of this preamp is to turn a balanced audio input into an unbalanced audio output. The headphones output is unbalanced standard 6.3 millimeters, and there's no adapter inside in the box, so you need to have a cable or the adapter. I will leave some examples of good cables with 6.3 millimeter size in the description. Let's talk about the price. Yeah, the price of the Geshelli Archel 3 Pro is $450 if you live inside the United States. Living in the European Union, you will spend around $1,600 with freight and taxes accounted for. Worth it? Yes, mainly for the tone control, because our headphones need minor corrections in the high and low frequencies, even if they are very subtle. If I were to establish an investment order in a setup to listen to music with a maximum quality on headphones, I would say, first, you need a good headphone. Second, you need a good amplifier with tone control, like the Geshelli Archel 3 Pro. And just in 30 position, you need a good deck. The amplifier will make much more difference to your sound than a DAC. Now I will stay here, pressing all the buttons of the Archel 3 Pro until you press the like button, please. If you click this button, YouTube will understand that you want to receive more videos like this one about our equipment, and will stop sending you those videos where the guys tell stories instead of talk about the equipment, you know. But you can tell me stories in the comments below.